When we come back, unfortunately, another sort of back-to-back tales of abuse, really. The Hell of Grenville with a couple of people who went to Grenville Christian College. I almost went to Grenville Christian College myself. Turns out, I'm thankful I didn't, after hearing about all the nonsense that went on at this school. Of course, I saw this W5 expose called In the Name of God, and we have two former students in the studio, well, one in the studio, one on the phone, who are going to join us and talk about their experience at this school. And part of me is just really disturbed that the fact that I've got these back-to-back stories, because it just, you know, I like to live in a bubble, Tim.
Yes, you do. That's why your head's shaped the way it is.
Really? This is too much, you know, when it comes to kids and spiritual abuse, right? This is the thing that gets me fired up.
I do know that. So let's put on some Celtic music before the...
Oh, yeah, that's not going to work. Yeah. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Broadcasting before and probably after the rapture. It's the Drew Marshal Show.
Take these shoes, click, clacking down some dead end street. Take these shoes and make them fit.
Thank you for tuning in. Again, you're listening to the Drew Marshal Show. We're streaming live at drewmarshal.ca. Aren't we, Megs? We are? We think, yes, we are. Okay, good. Sometimes things break and we don't stream. But we are live here in Southern Ontario on Joy 1250. Back-to-back abuse segments is something I've never done on this show. And there's a reason. Because they're too stinking heavy. And I can't make jokes, and it's not how I roll.
Well, you could make jokes. You just have to be sensitive about it. In front of your head.
Oh, man. Well, the other reason that this story is a little bit close to home for me is because I remember the literature from Grenville Christian College being on the dining room table when my parents were desperately wanting to get rid of me because I was turning into a bit of a rat bag as a kid.
Turning?
So they sent me to Pickering College instead. My last year there, it burned down.
So
this next segment is called The Hell of Grenville with Andrew Hale-Byrne and Heather Bakken. Bakken bits. I creeped on you. I know you a little bit about you, Heather. Thank you for being in studio, Heather.
My pleasure.
I appreciate you being here very, very much. It's always nice to see someone's eyeballs. But Andrew's eyeballs are way over in the UK. Andrew, you're on the phone with us right now, I hope?
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much for having me, Drew.
Well, a couple of things. First of all, you know, you British people can talk about anything and just sound really smart. So it is a pleasure to have you on my show. It just ups the smart level. Andrew is one of many students who are telling their story of abuse at one of Canada's premier boarding schools, Grenville Christian College. He's the author of Grenville, a book that you can certainly find online, grenvillebook.com. In 2007, he exposed the cult boarding school known as Grenville Christian College, Canadian press, basically. And you know, W5 took it a little bit later. I think it was just, was it not just this past
February
that the expose came out? So there has been an Anglican church inquiry. The OPP did an investigation. There's an ongoing class action lawsuit, and Andrew and Heather are here to tell their stories. Andrew, you know, this is going to be tough getting through your story and your passion. You and I chatted on the phone this week, and I said to you, good night, there's so much to talk about. So we've got to just touch on the main points during this interview. You ended up going there because your parents I guess, wanted to get rid of you as well. Is that true?
Well, actually, no. I would actually disagree with it. My parents sent me there because they wanted the best for me, and it was recommended by friends of theirs. And it advertised as an elite Anglican boarding school, and they received the promotion literature. And so I went there with my parents, and I said to my parents, of all the schools we visited, please send me here. It was absolutely beautiful. They're on the St. Lawrence River, etc. So I just have to say, no, my experience is different from yours in the sense that I wanted to go to Grenville.
Right.
But, of course, shortly after I arrived, I realized I had just woken up in a horror film.
How shortly after you arrived?
It was something was really upon the very first day. Some of the regimentedness, the sleep deprivation. You were never allowed to even have friendships. That was considered idolatry. But when the penny sort of dropped and I was landed somewhere quite abnormal, was there one of the main methods of indoctrination was a practice called a light session. And these were regular systemic practices at the school, which were these humiliations. They could happen privately, where they would drag you out of bed in the middle of the night, or they would stand you up in the chapel in front of the entire student body and staff and just rip you apart verbally, calling you names like slut, whore, pig, filth, trash, garbage. And in my case, I was regularly suffered this, and indeed I was called these things on such a regular basis by the staff that after 2 years of being there, I normalized it, and I believe that this was all that I deserved.
Wow. They must be very, very good at this for you to get to a point where you thought that this is what you deserved. This all, if I understand things correctly, this institution became this way because they were involved with a group in Cape Cod called the Community of Jesus. What are they about, and how do they do that? How do I say this? Is what they practice at the Community of Jesus identical to what was practiced at Grenville?
From the ex-members of the Community of Jesus that I've spoken to, they tell me that everything at Grenville was out of the founder's playbook. In fact, all the children of the founders of that cult have left and actually contributed to my book, Grenville by Andrew J. Hale-Byrne. They've told me that it was basically identical.
It wasn't just a bastardization of what they were trying to do with the Community of Jesus that the Grenville folks got wrong and kind of took down a Kool-Aid route.
Grenville was a satellite of the cult, and Charles Farnsworth, what we've stated in the lawsuit, is that Father Charles Farnsworth and Father Al Haig incorporated the teachings and practices of the Community of Jesus cult in Massachusetts into this Grenville, this Anglican school in Ontario, unbeknownst to our parents, and others. So, like I said, my parents obviously never would have sent me there had they known any of this.
Specifically, what happened to you, Andrew?
Specifically, what happened to me was, my parents were, like I said, one of the best for me, but I arrived there, and I made the grave error of asking questions.
Uh-oh. I got in trouble for that stuff, too.
And I my parents were intellectual there, and they had encouraged me to have an inquiring mind and read their books, etc., whether it would be the Bible or Karl Marx, and they were intellectuals. And so I was well read, and I simply asked them. I asked the Dean of Men, Don Farnsworth. I said, "Is this Community of Jesus a part of the Episcopal Diocese of Boston, the nearest diocese to you on the Cape?" And he said yes, which was an outright lie. I learned later, after I left, they'd applied to join the Episcopal Diocese of Boston, and they refused on the grounds they were a cult. Hence, they then looked north of the border to the Anglican Diocese of Ontario, based in Kingston, and they, of course, embraced them and ordained Charles Farnsworth without any education, higher education of any kind, no the necessary qualifications that they would require of their own clergy, and they did so at the behest of the founders of the cult, the self-styled Mother Kay and Mother Judy.
What happened to you?
Basically, like I said, I'd be dragged out of bed. I was, even some of the practices bled through to the classroom. But primarily the theaters of the torture, and this was degrading, inhumane treatment and torture that is mentioned in law, where you are starved on occasion, made to do food preparation whilst they're starving you, locked in a walk-in freezer to, freeze the demons out of you. I suffered exorcisms, plural, to rid me of the sin of dyslexia, because they said that unconfessed sin had invited Satan into my life to cause the dyslexia. So exorcisms were practices, and like I said, friendships. When I would develop friendships, they would say, that's idolatry. You need to be totally devoted to the leaders here and to God. Well, that meant, it was, you know, like I said, so it was, like I said, there was no moment to yourself. You could make any independent decisions. You were constantly monitored. You would go into the library and you would open the newspapers, and the articles would be cut out by Margaret Ortolani every morning. Couldn't call home. And of course, at the time as a kid, I had no idea what was happening to me, that I was in this mind control cult. I didn't know what that was at 15, 16, 17.
Andrew, but none of these things are against the law, are they? Otherwise, the OPP would have brought charges against Grenville?
Well, I was aware, and I was assaulted by Dan Ortolani, but I was also aware of the sex abuse at the time. But like I said, it was very hush-hush, but I was aware of Robert Farnsworth, who I did report to the police, and other people did. And I said, look, he was raping boys at the school. We knew it then. We certainly know more about it now. And they wouldn't even interview him. They wouldn't even question him. And I've also written to the police commissioner for Ontario, Vince Hawkes, and said, look, we've had a national broadcast where a former senior administrator at the school has admitted that there was sex abuse at the school. And why won't you investigate? You know, and I got no word back whatsoever.
This is Joan Childs that said...
Joan Childs, yes.
And during the W5 broadcast, she was asked directly about the abuse allegations, and she said, yes, I was aware of them. Yes, they did happen.
Yes, and she said that no one was held to account. And I've written to the police commissioner of Ontario, Vince Fox, and he's not responded. I've also written to the bishop of the Anglican Diocese of Ontario, Michael Alton, and, you know, they put out a statement off the broadcast distancing themselves from the school and saying, oh, we didn't know these people very well, and except for the bishops were on the board of the school with the cult members, etc. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, they're turning around. With one hand, they say, we hardly knew these people, and the next minute, they put an announcement out that on the 12th of June, they're going to ordain Julia Case, former Grenville vice principal, one of the worst offenders, as a deacon in the Anglican Diocese of Ontario, and that's the first step to becoming a priest. So they've clearly learned nothing.
At the risk of getting sort of all Oprah on you here, because that's so antithetical to the culture that you're from, how do you feel about this? I mean, I actually want to talk about feelings, which I know in the UK is the first F word. How do you feel about this?
As someone who, my family and I have a strong tradition of human rights activism, and this, you know, the exposure of Grenville is in keeping with that tradition. When I took it on, as I've taken on other, you know, social justice causes before in my private life at Grenville, I thought this would be one of those. But it's obviously become very personal because I was actually there. I was aware of some of what was going on when I was there, and I suffered, you know, obviously the common issues whilst I was there. Mm-hmm. So obviously it is very personal, but also helping people and also exploring my own faith. You know, I was advised by clergy. I'm a practicing Anglican. I was advised by my own clergy before I did this that forgiveness does not forgo justice. And that's what this is about. It's not about revenge. I know it is for some people, but for me it's not. It's about justice, exposing the truth, and simply I'm not asking the Anglican Church at this point for an apology. Any such apology, given their recent behavior, would be hollow. We simply want them to admit that they made a mistake in ordaining Charles Farnsworth, Father Gordon Mintz, the last headmaster of Grenville, who, by the way, Gordon Mintz's salary is paid by your taxes, Drew, as a Canadian Armed Forces chaplain. I think that the sense of injustice goes deep, and that's why I wrote the book. Because, you know, we warned the armed forces that don't take on, you know, Father Gordon Mintz. We told the Children's Aid Society, don't take on, you know, Judy Stewart McNeil, former Grenville Dean of Women. You know, they hired her right after the closing of the school in the midst of the exposure of all this. This school was associated with the establishment. The establishment doesn't want to admit this happened. They want this to go away. They want it swept under the carpet, as the Anglican Church did with two official church inquiries into this years ago, one by Bishop Mason and one by Bishop Bruce. You know, they want this all to go away. They celebrate. They don't just, you know, exonerate or you know, ignore the abuse. They actually celebrate the abusers. They're going to ordain Julia Case, as I said. Mm. They've never disciplined Gordon Mintz, and they treat us, the abuse survivors, as criminals. Like, we're the bad people for raising this unpleasantness.
Yes.
So a huge sense of injustice to answer your question.
Certainly.
Like I said, we need validation. People need them to admit what they did was wrong so people can go away and have closure.